You can't but be affected and infected by somebody that's gifted with the heart of a shepherd like Harry is. And so I said, Harry, we're going to be all together at one place at one time. You want to share? He says, only one condition. I share first. Because most of the time, everybody, all these other speakers speak your material because Holy Spirit's like that. And then you at the end and you are scrambling to find material because John's already preached it and Dave's already preached it and Lenny's already said it and prophesied it. And then Harry is scratching. Harry, come up here and I just show your wonderful face. You're just such a darling. I'm so happy that you're with us. He's been visiting with his daughter and son-in-law and the four grandchildren up in Connecticut. And so he's now down here with us for 6 weeks. So I'm going to, yeah. So we need some labor in the building. So I've recruited him. Hallelujah. Harry, it's nice having you with us. We love you so much. I'm going to let you minister the word because it's rich in you. I heard you mumbling in the Holy Ghost this afternoon. And I knew, watch out, brace your seatbelts. Harry's a coming. So I just want to pray for you, Father. Thank you for Harry. Thank you for our marker, Harry. We thank you that we find this gift right in our midst, and we thank you that this gift affects and infects because it flows by the Holy Ghost. And so, Father, we thank you that as Harry gets to minister, our hearts are open. We're ready to understand you in a bigger and greater capacity so that we can go beyond all limits to love in a greater capacity, and we give you praise for that. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's switch you on. We good to go up here. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you, Rod. Well, it's wonderful to be here. It really is. I've had a lovely time, 4 weeks with my Rebecca and Warren and my grandkids, and I met the latest one, little Jonathan. And I added them all to myself. So it's just wonderful, isn't it wonderful? When I was told by the doctor, I might get a little emotional in my chat, so bear with me. When I was told by the doctor that my darling wife was going to lose her vocal cords and not be able to speak again, I was in the hospital, Kruger Hospital in Cape Town. They told us that they had to take her thyroid out and they had to take her vocal cords and voice box out, and that she wouldn't speak again. Maybe she would. And I got in my car and I drove around Cape Town, down to the 12 Apostles. It's a hotel. Went in. I got a lovely conservatory room in that hotel. And I went in there and sat down to have a chat to God about where I found myself. And while I was sitting there talking to God about it, pouring out my heart, the Holy Spirit said to me clearly, are you going to blame God for this? Are you going to blame me? Are you going to allow this, what's happening to your wife, to let the scandal fall on you, the offense, and be offended with God? And the Holy Spirit said to me, are you prepared to trust me through this time? And I searched my heart. I was there for a while. And I said to God, I said, I choose to trust. And the moment I said it, the weight of what I was going through at that period of my life lifted. Not completely, but it lifted. And it brought me into what I want to share with you. Unshakable truth. Unshakable truth into acceleration. As you know, acceleration has been something we've been talking about as churches over this last year. And it's just to find yourself in a place of turmoil in your life is a test of faith. And it brings you into a place of where you have to decide where you stand in going forward. And I chose to stand in the truth of Almighty God. And my desire was that God would take me from where I was into acceleration, into the rest of my life, whatever God might have for me. Now, acceleration can mean a lot of different things to different people. For me, it means speed. And maybe you'd like to, can you jump a slide and put up that? I'll come back to that. Put the car up. There it is. Okay, this is a Bugatti Veyron made by VW. It's got a V16 motor, two V8 engines they put together. It's 8 liters. It goes from 0 to 100 in 2.5 seconds. And has a maximum speed of 267 miles an hour. It's in the Guinness Book of Records as the fastest street legal car in the world. And I told the church at home, I said, I really feel that in this present place that I find myself in with my wife, that you need to purchase one of these for me. It only costs 1.2 million euros. Jokes aside there. This is the core scripture that God gave me at that time. Proverbs 3, verse 4 through 10. And it's up on your screen, but I want to give it to you in the message. In the message it says, trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure everything out on your own. Listen for the voice, for God's voice in everything you do and wherever you go. He is the one who'll keep you on track. Isn't that a lovely scripture? It really is a lovely scripture. One of the most difficult things that we find ourselves having to do in this present age is relinquishing control to someone else. Very difficult to do that, to depend totally on someone else in your life to guide you and to keep you. And trust is one of those things that where you have to relinquish if you want to trust. If you've got a child that I know I did it many times with Paul, he'd be standing on something high and I'd say jump and he just jumps because he has that trust where he can just do it. Dad's going to catch him every time. But trust is always found through relationships. That's where trust is found. With God in marriage, with your kids in business and sport, and within the church. So to develop trust with God is the most wonderful thing that you could do. The more you get to know God and get to know his character, the more you are able to trust him. And I think back to that time in the 12 Apostles Hotel, and I thank God for what God had done with me up to that present time, how God had motivated me, how God had kept me, all the things that God had done for me, all the prayers that had been answered by God up to that present time in my life, in my children's lives, in other people's lives, how faithful he was. And I thanked him. And it gave me a little bit of an edge to go forward. You get an edge through relationship. And I had an edge. I wasn't cold turkey for me. This happened. I didn't even know God. I had a relationship for years with God. And now I faced a serious thing in my life where I had to trust him. And I had the edge to do it. But in Philippians 3, verse 10, it says, for my determined purpose is that I might know him, that I might progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly. And I love it. Did you see the word progressively? Moving forward into acceleration. Now, my acceleration at this time was not very fast. It was a slow acceleration. I was in electrical car mode, just moving. And but I was moving. And I think it's so important that when you find yourself in life in places that are very difficult, that you don't stagnate or stay in the place where you are mostly hurt, that you are strong enough in your belief and your trust to be able to move with God and move forward. And I was moving. The more that you get to know him and understand him and see him, the more you see his character, the more you are able to trust him when the rubber really meets the road. And it had met the road for me. In Jeremiah 17:7, it says, most blessed is a man who believes in trust and relies on the Lord, and whose hope and confidence is in the Lord. This is what I call bedrock belief, the Word of God. It's unshakable, absolute trust. Everything that is truth came from the truth. There's no truth that didn't come from the truth. And the truth is the Word of God. And everything that is truth came from the truth. And it's absolute. It's unshakable. Unshakable is a belief, feeling, or opinion strongly felt and unable to be changed. Absolute is not qualified or diminished in any way. Total, absolute, and secure, established, settled, and defined. That's the Word of God. Yeah. And you're going to have that kind of absolute belief in your hearts, in life, all the time. That regardless of what happens to you, regardless of where you find yourself, or what might happen to a loved one, or might happen to you in life, that you know in your heart without a shadow of a doubt that you can trust God. You can put your trust in Him. This was my bedrock. I put my trust in God. Most blessed a man who believes in, trusts in, and relies on the Lord. It's just the most wonderful thing. So God invites us to this kind of relationship, this trust relationship. Trusting God is one of the greatest honors that you can give Him, to trust Him. You honor Him when you trust Him. And I want to emphasize that trust is an obligation that we owe God. It's a privilege that He makes available to us. We are invited into this relationship of trust. He makes Himself available so we can trust. He gives us His Word so we can see who we can trust in and how we trust. And He gives us this assurance of being able to trust Him. And that's where I found myself in this place of saying, okay, God, I will trust You going forward. Regardless, I will trust You. And I remember clearly, I don't know if you were with us, Al, I think you were. We went to the speech therapist. They did the operation on Dee. They gave her a trachee. She had a little hole in her neck to breathe. And we didn't know at that time that they'd fitted a little device in her neck where she could pass air over it. And the speech therapist helped her how to breathe from her diaphragm and be able to pass air over this little device in her neck. And she said to me, I love you, Harry. Those were the best I love you I've ever heard. I love you, Harry. Valerie was there. And she got her voice back. Not the same one. It was a bit rough at first. But when you think there's never going to be a voice, and then there is one, and you chose to trust God for a voice, and you hear it, it's that a trust is not an obligation in that we are God, but it's a privilege He's made available to you that you can just walk into in any time of your life. Okay, now get it together, Harry. Webster's Dictionary defines trust as assured reliance on the character, ability, strength, and truth of someone or something, one in which confidence is placed. So I placed my confidence in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I placed my confidence in the Word of God, and I still do, and I always will. Yeah. And in Proverbs 29:25, it says, he who puts his trust in the Lord will be safe. And in that time, I was safe. God kept me safe through that time. Even though it was horrific, He kept me safe. Trust in God enables us to live without weights and burdens because we have confidence that someone else can deal with those things. Psalm 55 verse 22 says, cast your burdens on the Lord, release the weight of it, and He'll sustain you. When you trust God, you're able to give your burdens to Him, and the weight of the burden He lifts from you and he sustains you. Sustain means to strengthen or support physically or mentally. And through that period, God strengthened me physically and he helped me mentally. Because the fight in life is not a physical one. It's a mental one. It's a mental fight. And you fight with thoughts, with imaginations, with all the stuff that you get bombarded with in your own thought life. Even as a firm believer, I had these thoughts that were coming and bombarding me. And I had to go to God and say, Father, you're going to have to help me here to be able to release the weight of it, to give it away and not keep it, and strengthen me and support me physically and especially in my mind. I can't lose it. I can't lose it. I lost it many times. I cried. It was obvious that happened. And I was very emotional and all of that. And I couldn't. I'd get in my car and I would decide to go somewhere and I'd get there and I couldn't get out. And I went through all those feelings. And listen to this. It says this in Psalm 37:23. It says, the steps of a man are established by the Lord and he delights in his way. It says, when he stumbles, he'll not fall, for the Lord upholds him with his hands. Now listen to it. It says, doesn't say if he might stumble. Doesn't say he could stumble. It says when he stumbles. Stumble, I looked up, means to stagger, to totter. I love that. To totter. To totter. To be thrown down. And I was stumbling. I need to really give my nose a good blow, but it's going to make a bit of a noise, eh? Found myself tottering, wobbling, swaying. You know that stumbling happens in life for everyone. We're not immune from it. It's a an accident, loss of a loved one. It's a major totter, major stumble. People posting lies on Facebook about you. Boyfriend kissing another girl. Yeah, I know. And the list goes on. And everyday life comes to every one of us. And every one of us can find ourselves in this place where we stumble. That's what it said. It said, when we stumble, we will not fall. Eh? For the Lord upholds us with his hands. So this is not a falling down. This is a stumbling in your walk. This is a stumbling in your mind. But it's not a falling down. And sometimes things happen to us that cause us to stumble, stutter, and to totter. And in those times, we have to have bedrock faith. We have to have absolutes. We have to know that absolutely I'm loved. Absolutely I can stand. Even though I'm tottering, I'm standing. Not because of me, because of him. So I stand because of that. And so I found myself in that place of that. And I must say that there were times when I felt sorry for myself. I did. And I felt that I was allowed to feel sorry for myself. And a little bit of self-pity and hurt and confusion and insecurity and depression came my way. And I put on the backpack of self-pity, you know. I was carrying it. I carried it for a while. And this is what we do when we go through circumstances that are beyond our control or things that happen, and we take it and try to carry it ourselves. And it's the heavy weights and the self-pity and the hurt and the confusion. I was confused, I must say. But I didn't doubt that all these things were happening. And the heavy burdens and its weight, I needed someone who I trusted enough to be able to give it to. And it's an amazing thing that it's sometimes very difficult to give away those things. Those heavy things, you like to hang on to them sometimes. You know, they feed your ego sometimes. You know, they feed you, especially if you go into a real place of self-pity. And then they feed you, and you're living with this stuff, but you don't have to. And the Lord said to me, you've got to give it away, Harry. You can't have it. And I cried out to God, and I said to him, how am I able to be able to accelerate from the place I find myself in? I said, Father, you know that this year, 2018, is the year of acceleration. How am I going to do it? How am I going to get out of this place of depression? And he said this to me. God said this to me clearly. He said, preparation always leads to trust. And with trust, you will always move into acceleration. Preparation always leads to trust. If you look in life, right through life, there's always preparation before there's trust. Always. In every area, there has to be preparation. He said to me, without preparation, you're going to stay where you are. And I said, Lord, what's preparation? And he says, it means this, to make ready beforehand for some purpose or use or activity, to put in the proper state of mind, to be put in the proper state of mind. And God wanted to prepare me into the proper state of mind in the place I found myself in. So I said to God, what is my preparation then? What must I do? And God said to me, you have to give the backpack to me. You have to trust me enough to give all those feelings, all those emotions, all those things that you're going through, you've got to give them to me. In Matthew 11, verse 28, it says, come to me, all you who are labor and heavy laden and overburdened, and I'll cause you to rest. George Miller says, the beginning of anxiety is the end of faith and trust. And the beginning of faith and trust is the end of anxiety. Preparation gives birth to trust, and trust will take you into acceleration. So I said to God, where will I find this? What do I do? And he took me to Proverbs 3, 5 through 7. And in the Message Bible, it says, trust the Lord from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure everything out on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do and everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on track. Trust the Lord from the bottom of your heart. To know that if you get a glass of water and it's got a cup and it's got dirty stuff in it, if you pour the water in, it fills the cup from the bottom until it gets to the top, and then it overflows and all that stuff that's in there flows out. And he says, trust the Lord from the bottom of your heart. Everything starts at the bottom in life. We start as a little thing at the bottom, and we grow up. We start in education at the bottom, and we grow up. We start in sport. Little Ben, my little chap back there with Rebecca, he's been chosen for gymnastics, and it's just incredible what they're doing with him, but he's starting at the bottom. They're training him on the horse. You know, when they go round and round the horse in gymnastics, and they got a bucket that they hang from the ceiling, and he puts his feet in the bucket, and then he puts his hand on the two little handles, the pommel handles on the horse, if you know gymnastics, and then he moves himself around in the bucket and steps over his arms as his legs come round, and he's starting from the bottom and coming up, and they are fixing his little muscles, adjusting his little muscles, getting his coordination all sorted out, so that later on he's going to get better and better, and eventually he'll be able to do it on the real thing. And God said to me, I want to fill you from the bottom of your heart with my love. He says, and then I had to dig deep in this. He says, I want you to allow me by my spirit to take my love, my wonderful love, and I want you to see this illustration. I want you to allow me to pour it in to your heart, and let it rise up within your heart, and remove the things that are there that are causing you a problem. It says, trust God from the bottom of your heart, it says in the scripture, And so I went to God. This is something that I went to God on, and I'm still going there, on a one-off. I went to God constantly and said, Father, I'm here today, and I've come for a fresh drink, please. I need a fresh drink. My heart is not quite right. And I need you to pour your love in, please, from the bottom of it, and allow it to bubble up. And God did that for me. He filled me afresh with his love when I asked him for it. And I was asking by faith for it. I was asking out of a place of hurt and, you know, all that stuff that I was living through. But he took his love and put it into Harry's heart and bubbled that stuff out. And it's constantly happening as we speak. I've got to go to him on a daily basis and say to him, okay, I'm struggling a little today. Some days it's great, some days it's not great. I don't have my wife anymore. I'm married for 40 years. Did everything together, ministry and everything. She was the most amazing, wonderful woman. And you know, it's hard. That's hard for anyone. But it's not a disaster for Harry. I mean, I miss her more than I can tell you. But if I trust him from the bottom of my heart and I see what he can do with his love for me, then I can handle it. So I did that. I allowed him to fill me up from the bottom of my heart and allowed that love of his to overflow out of me and to lift that burden, some of those burdens. That's how I got rid of some of the burdens. I visualized him filling me on a daily basis. I said, fill me, Lord, with the love. And he would fill me with the love. And then I would say, thank you. And then the next day when I woke up in the morning and I said, Lord, I don't want to be greedy here. Harry, don't. But I'm not going to make it through the day today unless you do this again. And he did it again.
Yeah.
And so I managed to walk through this thing, and that helped me to give the burden back to him and the weight of it. That's how he washed me out of it. So that's what he did in my heart. Then it says, don't try and figure everything out on your own. And this is very important. Because sometimes we try and work it all out on our own. And I would just thank God that I had Rod and Val, Valerie there for a long time. I had Lynn. And I had the body of Christ. I had the local church. And I had Chris Spengler and other people there that are very close to me. And God showed me afresh that it is essential in life to be in a family in church. It's essential. Because it says here, don't try and figure out everything on your own. And so often we try and figure it out. And I had my own times of trying to figure this all out. But I had other people that I knew, trusted God like I did, knew that the word was absolute, had faith. And I could approach them and say, today I'm feeling like this. I don't quite know what I'm going to do with my life going forward. Can you help? Can you give me some counsel in this? And the body of Christ, the wonderful body of Christ, the people came alongside me and helped me. And they, some of them not even knowing it, some of them I don't have a strong relationship with. I had to go to a wedding out in the middle of nowhere. Anyway, I went to a wedding and it was one where you all go there and you stay there for the weekend. Then they had the wedding, and then they had the party, and then they had the dance, and then I had no one to dance with. And I was feeling sorry for myself. And there was a young girl there with her husband. And she read me, came up to me, put her arms around me, and loved me. I just stood there, and she put her arms around me, and she loved me. She didn't say anything to me. She didn't do anything. But God showed her how much I was pining for D. And God, dear, don't try and figure everything out on your own. You've got to have other people in your life. That's why church life is so essential to us and to the world. So I didn't try and figure it out. I wasn't proud. And I went and I asked for help, and God helped me. Then it says in the third verse says, listen to the voice of God in everything you do and wherever you go. And I think that's also essential, that we don't allow the circumstances that we find ourselves in block us from going forward, especially to be able to hear the sweet voice of the Holy Spirit as he directs us. So I availed myself to God in the Spirit to be able to hear what he's saying to me in going forward, and it helped me. And then he says, here's the one who will keep you on track. And so he's the one that will keep you. When I read that, because I used to run when I was young, it talked to me about acceleration, and he's got me on the track. And because I did these things and allowed God to do what he did, God has kept me and is keeping me on the track. And so that was my preparation into being able to be with God in this unshakable trust, was to trust God, allow him to fill my heart up afresh with his precious love on a daily basis. Don't try to figure it out myself, and listen closely to the word of God. Listen closely to the voice of the Spirit, and God just did something for Harry. It's an ongoing process. I'm not perfect yet, but I'm getting close to it. And I wanted to leave that with you. So let me pray for you. Father, I bless you. Thank you for the word of God, which is sharper than a two-edged sword, able to pierce thoughts and intents of the heart and bring healing. And I thank you for all these people that are here. That I need to ask you today, if you're sitting here and you need the bottom of your heart filled with the love of God to wash something out. I don't know what it might be. But if you find yourself in that place today, then I ask you simply to stand where you are. If you want to be washed from the bottom of your heart out for something to be removed, then just simply stand where you are, and I'll pray for you. And we'll ask God to do that for you. Just come with his precious love and flood you afresh from the very bottom of your heart, and remove what it is that needs to be flushed out, and bring you into a place of wholeness, wellness, sound mind, and able to hear the voice of God. So, Father, I thank you for all those that are standing, and I stand with them, Father. And once again, I ask you, sincerely ask you, Lord, to fill us all from the bottom of our hearts with the love of God, a fresh outpouring of the love of God to flood our hearts, Father. We receive it by faith, and we ask you, Lord, as it comes and fills us, that anything we might be carrying, any hurt, any concern, any weight, any heaviness, Lord, that you would lift the heaviness off these people in Jesus' precious name, that you would give them hope, confidence in the unshakable trust of God, the unshakable truth of God, the unshakable word of God. And I thank you for that, Lord. A fresh touch of the Spirit, a fresh touch of the love of God in Jesus' precious name. And everyone said, amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Harry. Reminder of the scripture, it says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life. And I stand because I want to make sure if there is anything there, it's in that heart, has to be flushed out. That's not God, you know, because I want to be able to be the vessel through which divine favor flows and allowing misfortune in the lives of others. So I want to be able to do that. That's a good start to the diet as we get together. Amen. So we're going to have a break, potty break, restroom break, and a coffee break. And I will yodel for you to return in about 10, 15 minutes. And John will be ready to share with us. So God bless you. Have a break, have a walk, and we'll call on you in a minute.
passions, they apart.